So I'm here to introduce Trav. They are a bisexual, genderqueer, secular humanist who blogs about the intersections of humanism and social justice at By Any Means, which is a blog on freethoughtblogs.com. They also host the By Any Means podcast and co-host the Bi-Skeptical podcast. Trav has also written a few times for thehumanist.com, and I highly recommend checking out some of the things that Trav has written for us, and I have no doubt that the same way that he informs us about issues related to genderqueer issues and social justice coming from a humanist framework, I have no doubt that those same prompts that he gives us, that they give us, excuse me, will be, will be the same informative take that they provide for us right now.
Hello, everyone. First, I want to thank the AHA for giving me this opportunity to speak to you all today. Hopefully, by the end of this, they won't think they made a huge mistake. And thank you all for being here. For those who don't know me, shame on you. My name is Trav Mamone. I'm a freelance writer who has written for Paste Magazine, The Humanist, Splice Today, Everyday Feminism, and The Establishment, among others. I am the host of the By Any Means podcast and co-host of the Bi-Skeptical podcast. Are you sensing a theme here? And I'm genderqueer. What does that mean, you're probably asking? I keep hearing about all this genderqueer, gender fluid, binary, non-binary, pronouns stuff, and I don't get it. Well, hopefully this talk will help some. So I think the best place to start is with basic terminology. You keep hearing all this stuff about transgender, cisgender, binary, non-binary, pronouns. So what the hell is everyone talking about? Well, let's take a look. For starters, we need to differentiate sex and gender. When we talk about sex, we're talking about biological sex. The American Psychological Association's guidelines for psychological practice with lesbian, gay, and bisexual clients says that biological sex, quote, refers to a person's biological status and is typically categorized as male, female, or intersex, which we'll get into later on. There are a number of indicators of biological sex, including sex chromosomes, gonads, internal reproductive organs, and external genitalia. So basically, we're talking about what you're born with. Then there's gender, which the APA defines as this. Gender refers to the attitudes, feelings, and behaviors that a given culture associates with a person's biological sex. Behavior that is compatible with cultural expectations is referred to as gender normative. Behaviors that are viewed as incompatible with these expectations constitute as gender nonconformity. Now, I know there's a lot of controversy about the whole gender as a social construct argument, and I wish I had the time and energy to go through all the available literature to explain all the nuances, but for right now, we'll just go with this definition. It's not that gender is made up or it doesn't exist, but that our ideas about what it means to be a man or a woman come from social norms. As former Promoting Secular Feminism co-host Demanda Wright once said in an episode, my vagina does not determine whether or not I choose to shave my legs. Now we get to the whole trans versus cis thing. According to the APA's guidelines for psychological practice with transgender and gender nonconforming people, transgender is an adjective that is an umbrella term used to describe the full range of people whose gender identity and or gender role do not conform to what is typically associated with their sex assigned at birth. Although the term transgender is commonly accepted, not all trans or gender nonconforming people self-identify as transgender. Cisgender, on the other hand, is an adjective used to describe a person whose gender identity and gender expression align with the sex assigned at birth, the opposite of transgender. So in other words, when you were born and the doctor said, it's a boy, and throughout your life you said, yes, I'm a boy, that's cisgender. Transgender, on the other hand, is when the doctor says, it's a boy, and you respond, no. A term you might hear throughout this presentation is gender dysphoria, which the APA defines as discomfort or distress related to incongruence between a person's gender identity, sex assigned at birth, and/or primary and secondary sex characteristics. It used to be called gender identity disorder, but they changed it to dysphoria in 2013 to basically say, you know, the feelings you're experiencing, there's nothing wrong with that. You were just, you know, realized that, you know, your assigned gender at birth doesn't match your gender identity. And now, because it used to be called gender identity disorder, some people think being transgender itself is a mental disorder, including one particular trans woman on YouTube who is absolute garbage, but I won't get into that right now. But no, being trans is not a mental disorder. If it was, why does the APA say that trans people are more likely to experience positive life outcomes when they receive social support or trans-affirmative care instead of conversion therapy? Now we get to the moment you've all been waiting for, what this whole genderqueer thing is all about. The APA defines genderqueer as a term to describe a person whose gender identity does not align with a binary understanding of gender, i.e., a person who does not identify fully as either a man or a woman. People who identify as genderqueer, may redefine gender or decline to define themselves as gendered altogether. For example, people who identify as genderqueer may think of themselves as both man and woman, bigender, pangender, and androgyne, neither man nor woman, which is known as being either genderless, gender neutral, neutral, agender, moving between genders, gender fluid, or embodying a third gender like two-spirit indigenous people. Did I get that right, Desiree? Good. All right. So now some people use the term nonbinary interchangeably with genderqueer, while others say nonbinary is different from genderqueer. I personally use both terms to describe myself, but everyone's different. There are only two genders, you damn SJW. Yeah, we get this a lot. So I think we have to go back and look at the difference between sex and gender. Once again, for those who missed it the first time around, biological sex is determined by genitals, chromosomes, and secondary sexual characteristics. Gender, on the other hand, is an identity that's based on a combination of biology slash neurology and social norms. But they do have one thing in common. Neither of them is binary. Wait, what's this? Biological sex isn't binary? It's true. Intersex people exist. According to the Intersex Society of North America, intersex is a general term used for a variety of conditions in which a person is born with a reproductive or sexual anatomy that doesn't seem to fit the typical definitions of male or female. For example, a person may be born appearing to be female on the outside but having mostly male typical anatomy on the inside. Or a person may be born with genitals that seem to be in between the usual male and female types. For example, a girl may be born with a noticeably large clitoris or lacking a vaginal opening, or a boy may be born with a notably small penis or with a scrotum that is divided so that it has formed more like labia. Or a person may be born with mosaic genetics so that some of the person's cells have XX chromosomes and some of them have XY. Now, it's estimated that one out of 2,000 people are born intersex, which, if memory serves, is roughly the same amount of redheads in the world. And I'm sure most of us know a lot of redheads, so chances are you might know someone who is intersex. Now, I mention all this because we're learning more and more from science that gender is a big ball of wibbly-wobbly, gendery-wendery stuff. We used to think gender only came in two options, male and female, and that genitals and chromosomes alone determine whether someone is a boy or a girl. However, within the past couple of decades, we're learning that there might be a neurological basis for gender identity. The most recent study was published in the Journal of Neuroscience in 2014. In this study, researchers from the Medical University of Vienna used diffusion-based magnetic resonance tomography, or MRT, brain scans on both cisgender and transgender men and women to compare the neurological differences between the subjects. The study concludes, the results of this study showed that the white matter microstructure in trans men and trans women falls halfway between that of cisgender women and cisgender men. What does that mean? Amanda Cohen of Ravishly.com explains it like this. A trans woman has significantly different brain movement than a cis man, despite having the same biological sex. Moreover, trans men and trans women were different from each other, implying that the brain shows a wide range of gender-based differences rather than simply male or female. Another study with similar results was published in 2011 by the Journal of Psychiatric Research. For this study, psychobiologists and neuropsychologists from Spain did MRI scans on 18 trans men, 19 cis women, and 24 cis men. The study concludes, our results show that the white matter microstructure pattern in pre-transition trans men is closer to the pattern of subjects who share their gender identity, males, than those who share their biological sex, females. What's interesting to note about this study is that it shows trans men's brain patterns are similar to cis men's before undergoing medical transitioning. Now, so far, all of the scientific literature about trans people has focused primarily on binary trans men and women. There's very little research on non-binary trans people. The closest scientific study anyone has done is a 2012 paper published in Medical Hypotheses that is a survey of 32 individuals who identify as bigender, sort of like a combination of man and woman. According to results, 14 participants said they involuntarily switched their gender identities on a frequent basis. The study also reports that 2/3 of the participants experienced moderate phantom body parts. The authors hypothesize that gender fluidity might be a neuropsychiatric condition, but it's just a hypothesis until there's more research. All right, but genderqueer isn't transgender, snowflake. Yeah, we hear this a lot too. Now, I will say this. Here's where things get tricky. Some genderqueer people call themselves trans, and some call themselves gender nonconforming, which basically means you don't conform to stereotypical gender norms in the way you present yourself. It depends on how the individual feels, to be honest. I will say this, though. The DSM-5 does describe gender dysphoria in a way that suggests non-binary people are included. So here's how the DSM-5 describes gender dysphoria in adolescents and adults. It says this, a marked incongruence between one's experience expressed gender and assigned gender of at least 6 months duration as manifested by at least two of the following. I'll skip the first three and go start with number four. A strong desire to be the other gender or some alternative gender different from one's assigned gender. Number five, a strong desire to be treated as the other gender or some alternative gender different from one's assigned gender. Number six, a strong conviction that has the typical feelings and reactions of the other gender or some alternative gender different from one's assigned gender. Now, did you catch that? Or some alternative gender different from one's assigned gender. Thus, according to gender therapist Christina Richards, non-binary people can fall under the trans umbrella. Also, Richards adds, it is likely that some people who previously would have identified as trans, that is, within the gender binary but moving across it, may have identified outside of the binary if that discourse had been available to them. Kind of like how some bisexuals first came out as gay, but later came out as bi. Now, the opposite happens too, of course. Some gay people first come out as bi, and some binary trans people first come out as non-binary. I don't have the exact numbers, of course, but I can't say which situation is more frequent, but maybe Richards is right. Maybe now that we're learning more about non-binary genders, more trans women and trans men will say, wait, that's a thing? We shall see. Now I know what you're thinking. This is just one person's opinion, right? Well then, let's see what others in the psychology field have to say. In the Frequently Asked Questions page of the Transgender Institute's websites, and for those who don't know, the Transgender Institute is a gender therapy and coaching organization based in Kansas City. They treat both binary and non-binary trans people and say this: we espouse the belief that there are more than two gender identifiers, many more, and provide individualized services dependent on our clients' unique gender identities. And then there's the World Professional Association for Transgender Health, or WPATH, whose current edition of their Standards of Care for the Health of Transsexual, Transgender, and Gender Nonconforming People publication says, if self-identified non-binary people experience gender dysphoria, they should be allowed to undergo medical transitioning. And then there's the APA's Guidelines for Psychological Practice with Transgender and Gender Nonconforming People, which I mentioned earlier, which recognizes gender as a non-binary construct that allows for a range of gender identities, and that a person's gender identity may not align with sex assigned at birth, and it encourages psychologists to adopt or modify their understanding of gender, broadening the range of variation viewed as healthy and normative. By understanding the spectrum of gender identities and, gender expressions that exist, and that a person's gender identity may not be in full alignment with sex assigned at birth, psychologists can increase their capacity to assist trans and gender nonconforming people, their families, and their communities. So, unless the psychological association's been hijacked by radical SJWs, I think it's safe to assume non-binary gender identities are now being acknowledged and affirmed by the professionals. Now, I want to go back to what I said earlier about how some genderqueer people identify as trans and some identify as gender nonconforming. I personally keep going back and forth between the two because while I do have some gender dysphoria, I often feel like it's not enough to really call myself trans. I'm perfectly fine with my chest and genitals, but my body hair, muscle mass, and football player shoulders really bother me. I don't have official numbers, but most of my non-binary friends experience similar unique forms of dysphoria, where they're okay with this part of their bodies, but not another part. I will say this, though. I used to see a gender therapist to help me sort out all these questions a few months ago. I haven't seen her in a while because I don't have the money, but I did have a breakthrough during one session. I told her I often look at women and wish that I looked like them. She asked me when I first had these kinds of thoughts, and I said in my mid-20s before I really knew what being transgender was all about. I also told her that for a while while I'm still up in the air about hormones, I really want to do laser hair removal to get rid of all my gorilla hair. My gender therapist said, well, you're definitely not cis. Cis men aren't uncomfortable with their body hair. Cis men don't look at beautiful women and want to look like them. So I'm not just a cis person appropriating trans language to make myself hip and cool. Oh, thank you, God, I don't believe in. So, yeah, that's why I call myself a non-binary trans person. Okay, but you're still a regressive leftist. Next. Okay, now that I'm done educating everyone about the basics of being genderqueer slash non-binary, I want to address those who might be having some questions about their own genders. I know it's really scary. You always kind of had this feeling that something was off, but you never knew what it was. Now you're hearing a lot more about you're hearing a lot more transgender voices, and you're thinking, huh, that kind of sounds like me. But of course, if you're like me, you're prone to jumping to conclusions in a single bound, so you're not sure if this is really a thing for you. Also, if you're like me, you hate not knowing the answer. Unfortunately, it's a journey. But I do have a few tips to make it a not-so-hard journey. First, if you can afford to do so, seek a gender therapist. If you live near a major city, there's probably one in your area. If not, you can go to the Transgender Institute that I mentioned earlier, which offers Skype therapy sessions. With a sliding scale, it's usually $100 a session, though. But since my gender therapist was through the Transgender Institute, it's worth it if you can afford it. Another good person to check out is Dara Hoffman Fox, who practices in Colorado. Dara only sees clients in the Colorado area, though, but Dara did write a great book called You and Your Gender Identity, A Guide to Self-Discovery, which you can get from darahoffmanfox.com. It's written in a way that gently guides you through discovering your gender identity, and it has self-care tips when things get too intense, so check that book out if you get a chance. Second, explore your presentation. That's how I eventually became comfortable with my genderqueer identity. First, I painted my nails, and I was like, ooh, nice. Then I started growing my hair out, I shaved off my beard, I started wearing women's clothes. I started wearing clothes from the women's section at Target, I started going by they, them pronouns, I started wearing lipstick, I started wearing eyeshadow, and every time I tried something new, it felt real to me. So play around with the way you look and see what makes you happy. Third, read some books about the subject. Besides Dara Hoffman Fox's book, there's Trans Bodies, Trans Selves, Transgender 101 by Nicholas Tagg, I think that last name is pronounced, Beyond Magenta, Transgender Teens Speak Out by Susan Cucklin, and Kate Bornstein's Gender Outlaws Anthology. And if there are any others that you recommend, be sure to mention them during the Q&A. Fourth, join some Facebook groups. There's the Facebook Transgender Alliance, Genderqueer, Agender, Neutral, Gender Fluid, and Nonbinary Discussion, and Nonbinary Support, to name a few. Now, I will say this. If you go to these groups and demand they tell you straight up whether or not you're trans, you're going to have a bad time. Only you can answer that question, but they'll gladly support you through your journey. Fifth, take your time. Like I said earlier, figuring out who you are takes some time, or at least it did for me. Don't beat yourself up if you don't have all the answers tomorrow. In fact, give yourself permission to take breaks and just enjoy fun stuff like playing Zelda. Sometimes you just have to be like Rocky and live the questions. Now we get to the part where I tell all you cis people to shut up and stay in your lane. But seriously, this is all new to a lot of you here, and naturally, being humanists, you don't want to be jerks, or at least I hope you don't want to be jerks. So what can you do? Well, here are a few good places to start. First, pronouns. Ask for them, respect them, and use them. Don't be like some of these pseudo-intellectuals you see on Twitter who say we're taking away your free speech simply by asking you to use our preferred pronouns. Even if it's some neo-pronoun like Z or her, if someone says my pronouns are Z, her, use them. It's just common courtesy. It's okay if you mess up by accident, as long as you don't fly off the handle when we correct you. That's not too much to ask for, is it? Second, listen to our stories. You don't have to understand this whole non-binary thing, but at least listen to our experiences and try to see where we're coming from, even if you don't understand. It humanizes the other, which is what humanism is all about, right? Third, don't flog yourself if you mess up. Like I said, this is all new stuff to a lot of people, so we don't expect everyone to get it right away. Or at least, I don't. Also, when cis people grovel when they make a mistake, I often feel like they're confessing to me like I'm a priest. I mean, don't get me wrong. I'm a very patient person and willing to forgive people for accidentally misgendering me. But I don't want to be your priest either, you know? Well, that brings me to the end of my talk. I hope I answered a lot of your questions, but if not, I'll be glad to answer them now. I know I probably missed a lot of stuff trying to cram everything into just half an hour, so now's the time to clear up some confusion. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Christy.
Hello.
Thank you for your presentation, Trav.
Thank you.
Very straightforward and honest. I appreciate that. Thank you. Along the line of asking about pronouns, I have a question about terms of address. In our society, I think the language we use not only says something about how we think, but it also influences how we think.
Mm-hmm.
And sir and ma'am are so ingrained in terms of address. And when I was in the Air Force, I felt very frequently like ma'am pointed out that I was not in the boys' club. They were letting me tag along.
Mm-hmm.
And so I don't think we need a third term of respect for trans people or genderqueer people. I think we need a term of respect that is inclusive to all humans. Mm. Do you have any suggestions?
That's a really good question. People ask me all the time if there's a gender-neutral version of sir or ma'am. I'm like, well, not that I know of. Being from the Baltimore area, I like to use the word hun, but...
that works in Tennessee also.
Okay, so I don't know. We should definitely work on that, though. Thank you.
Thank you.
I just have kind of a broad question about a word that I've heard that many other people maybe don't know about, which is to dead name someone.
Ah, yes.
Could you expand upon what it means to dead name someone?
Sure. Basically, a trans person's dead name is usually the name they were given at birth, which usually doesn't align with the gender identity. For example, let's use Caitlyn Jenner. If you dead name her, you would refer to her as Bruce Jenner, right? Even though, you know, all of her days as Bruce are long gone. She's now Caitlyn. And so, in fact, I used to work with someone who kept referring to her as Bruce Jenner. I was like, it's Caitlyn. And I think she said something like, not alone, she got that, still got that thing between her legs. I'm glad I'm not working there anymore. Yes.
I'm Pal Moore from Chapel Hill.
Mm-hmm.
How many genderqueers are not bisexual? What proportion of one is the other?
Yes. Well, most non-binary people I know also are also in the middle of the sexual spectrum like I am. In fact, I remember for a while when I first realized I was both sexually and, you know, gender fluid, I thought basically they were the same thing. You know, oh, I'm androgynous because I'm bi. But then I kind of realized, oh, wait, there's a whole gender component, too? That makes a lot of sense. Hopefully that answers your question. As far as exact numbers, I don't quite know.
Thank you for being here and rushing over from speaking at the Faith and Freedom Coalition. I wanted to know, I have many friends and family who are very open about alternative gender identities, but often they get stuck when they see a child, elementary school age or a young child who identifies as transgender or something else, and their parents are accepting of that, and they say, oh, they don't know. They're too young to know. I'm pretty sure, I don't know what age, but I knew very young, you know, about that I was cisgender. I didn't know the word, but, you know. So what age, or is there consensus about generally what age a child would actually know?
You know what? I think I read something about that, but I don't quite remember. I want to say around 4 or 5. I could be totally wrong, though. But then again, some trans people don't really get it until, like, later on in life. You know, they might always have this sort of, you know, something's not quite right until later on they learn the word transgender. Like, oh, there's a word for that. So, I want to say 4 or 5, but I could be totally wrong.
That was the last question. She wanted to know what SJW stood for.
SJW stands for Social Justice Warrior, which, depending on who you ask, can mean something different. For some people, Social Justice Warrior means basically a left-wing troll who, like, you know, You know, basically, it's not enough that, you know, you did something wrong. People say, hey, that wasn't cool, you move on. It's like, no, you did something wrong, and therefore, you need to go to the gulag. But a lot of other people think social justice warrior means pretty much anyone who is a feminist, anyone who says Black Lives Matter, anyone who says that, you know, they believe there are more than two genders. Like, I remember so many people, like, when I, in online spaces, when I say that I'm a feminist, you know, they automatically assume, so, you want to silence people you don't like, right? We weren't talking about that, were you? You want to kill all, you hate men, don't you? We weren't talking about that. How does one from the other, you know? It's like saying to an atheist, it's like, oh, you're an atheist? Well, obviously, you're a Satan worshiper. You all just automatically assume that, I don't know. You gotta love online, you gotta love social media, right?
All right, thank you so much, Trav. Appreciate it.